Hello and welcome to my channel, Vice Trino here. Today I am continuing on with the Dinosaurs and the Bible talk that was given by Chris Ashcraft, the self-debunking apologist. I'm curious to see if he'll continue undermining his own points as he progresses through his talk. When we left off, he had proclaimed the family Felidae to be a biblically created kind, so lions, leopards, and house cats are all the same kind, but civets, genets, and linsangs are a different kind, despite their obvious similarities to the other cats. Let's see where he goes from here.
So the lions and the tigers and the cheetahs and all the domestic cats and your bobcats and everything else have all descended from one pair of cats that was on board the Ark. The canines as well.
Well, this one isn't quite as obvious as with the Felidae family. I have to go to extinct animals to get to the obviously dog-like animals that aren't in the Canidae family, like the bear dog, but the point still stands. Fun fact, if you just pop up one level in the phylogenetic tree to the Caniforma clade, that includes bears, raccoons, walruses, seals, skunks, weasels, badgers, otters, and more. In fact, if you recall from part one, he said that the biblical kind corresponds to the family level of taxonomy, at least for mammals. So if we look at the Mustelidae family, that includes weasels, badgers, ferrets, and otters, among others. So if you're okay with an otter being the same kind as a ferret and a badger, then you might as well just say you're okay with evolution. Also, we have taxonomic families in here with just one single living representative, like the red panda. All of its relatives are extinct. So Noah had one pair of animals on the Ark that would eventually lead to ferrets, badgers, weasels, and otters, another pair of animals that would lead to raccoons, kinkajous, and ring-tailed cats, but then he had to have a completely separate breeding pair just to lead to the one species, the red panda, that is basically a cross between a badger and a raccoon. Oh yeah, and you might have noticed my inclusion of the ring-tailed cat in the raccoon family. Just add that to the list of cat-looking animals that aren't in Felidae. These guys are a lot more closely related to dogs than to cats, despite looking like a cat that stole a raccoon's tail. This is why creationists generally keep the definition of kind to be rather vague. As soon as you pin it down in any way, shape, or form, it becomes obvious that you either have to accept evolution in its entirety to account for all the members of whatever group you associate the word kind with, or you have to have way too many animals on the Ark than is plausible. I mean, realistically, no matter where you put it, you still have too many animals on the Ark to be plausible, but the closer to the species level it goes, the worse the problem gets.
Think about the amount of variety that you see in all the dog breeds. That's the kind of a variability that was available to the canines, to that one pair of canines that was on board Noah's Ark. Okay, so if this is true, think about this amount of variability, and then you can better understand why there didn't have to be a whole lot of dinosaurs on board Noah's Ark.
Sure. If you accept evolution, you don't have to have all that many animals on the Ark in order to get to the diversity of life that we have today. But there are a couple of problems here. First is time. I've run the numbers for this before, so I'm not going into great detail right now, but in order to get from the number of animals that AIG claims were on the Ark to the number of animal species that we have today, we would need to have four new species evolving every single day for the last 4,000 years. Why do we not still see this rate of evolution today? But then we get to a new problem. You say he didn't need all that many dinosaurs on the Ark in order to represent all the different species of dinosaur that we know about. Okay, sure, but isn't it supposed to be a primitive form that Noah took on the Ark? The unevolved basal original version that God created? That's the usual creationist argument. But if all of the diversity that we see in the fossil record had already happened, then what does that mean? Creationists generally like the concept of genetic entropy, that our genes are degrading over time, so the variety that was available to the original created kinds is no longer available to us today. Well, that would mean that there would have been much less variety in Noah's day, as the species had not diversified yet, which would mean that we wouldn't expect to see as much variety in the fossil record as we do, as those species should only have developed after the flood, as the original created kinds diversified and then lost their ability to diversify further. In other words, we shouldn't have the 700 species of dinosaur that we know of all represented in the fossil record. There should be only a handful of the original dinosaur kinds. There are thousands of animal families still around today, and we have evidence of thousands more extinct families in the fossil record. And you want to include all of them on the ark?
There was a bunch of different hadrosaurs, including like your pachycephalosaur and all these, well, a whole bunch of different hadrosaurs, but there would only needed to be one pair of hadrosaurs, not all the different species, not from all the different genera, just one pair from that family needed to be on board Noah's Ark.
Okay, that's nice. Which one? And when the flood was over, did that one species re-diversify into all of the same species of hadrosaur again? Or did it diversify into new species of hadrosaur? Do we have any fossils of the new species of hadrosaur that it developed into? And how can we tell which ones were the pre-flood species and which were the post-flood species? Were the post-flood ones in the upper levels with humans? Why then do we not actually find any with humans? Did fossilization miraculously stop happening after the flood, even though we know that catastrophic flooding and other fossil-creating disasters still happen today? You might not be actively debunking yourself again, but you are certainly making points that bring up a lot of unanswered questions.
But some of these are really big, you know? So what about the size of these things, too? Some of them were massive, like the big Gigantosaurus, the theropods, like I showed you the Gigantosaurus. The T-Rex is also a theropod, along with the Gigantosaurus.
Yeah, what about the theropods? Aren't they all super-duper big? No, they weren't, as I'm sure you're about to point out. But here's the thing. If you're going to say that all theropods were represented on the Ark, this is where evolution could help you. We've already established that with your definition of a biblical kind, you must accept that some badger-like land creature could evolve into an otter. So the idea that a theropod dinosaur could have evolved into modern birds is definitely one that could be included in your worldview. So you don't even need to account for T-Rexes. The Bible clearly states that small feathered avian theropods were on the ark, so explicitly that no atheist could possibly deny it. In fact, the theropods played a crucial role in helping Noah figure out when the floodwaters receded. But while a badger being related to an otter is an acceptable amount of evolution, an apatoraptor being related to a bird is just a bit too much for you. But then, that brings us to another problem. You said that the kind divider was akin to family for mammals. Does that mean it's somewhere else for other groups like reptiles and birds? It would have to be, since, you know, theropod isn't a family. If we're going down to the family level, then Tyrannosauridae is a family, the smallest member of which was still big enough to weigh a literal ton. And then you'd still have to have the dromaeosaurids represented, that's the family that Velociraptor is in. And the megalosaurids, another group of large ones. And therizinosaurids. I could keep going, there are lots of families of theropods, a few of which only have large species as members.
Remember, God sent those animals to Noah to be kept alive. God would have specifically chosen the animals with the right health and the right age and the right size, you know, that was to be released on the earth after the flood.
Which raises yet another question. Why would God bother saving the species that he knew would go extinct right after the flood? Why waste the space on the ark? It's already cramped, especially now that we need to account for all of the extinct animals, but then pretty much right after they get off the boat, boom, dead, all of them, forever. I'd be pretty pissed off if I were Noah, working my ass off to save all these animals, a lot of which probably want to eat me, being the big nasty carnivores that they are. Like, seriously, caring for a horse on a rocking boat can be dangerous. I would hate to have to look after Aeloramus, the small tyrannosaur whose juveniles were about 5 meters long.
Okay, if the Bible is an accurate history book, and if our interpretation of the fossil record is correct...
Those are a couple of really big ifs. Do you have anything to back them up?
As being due to the global flood, then the dinosaurs are part of the fossil record. They had to be alive at the time of the global flood. They were on board Noah's Ark as well.
Yeah, so according to you, every single land animal to be represented in the fossil record must have been aboard the Ark, because if they're in the fossil record, they were alive at the time of the Flood. So I guess that means that the creatures that went extinct immediately after the Flood didn't have to diversify into all the different species of the family. So, you know, the hadrosaurs could have had one couple on the Ark, and it could have ended with them. Fossilization doesn't happen anymore, because reasons, but again, why bother putting these dangerous, hard-to-care-for animals on the Ark if they're just going to go extinct right after the Flood? And if the entire fossil record is comprised of organisms that died in Noah's Flood, then that means, with the amount of biological material represented in the Earth's crust, there was somewhere between 122,000 to 348,000 times the biological material that exists on the Earth today, with the photosynthetic organisms capturing some 12,000 to 1.2 million times the amount of energy every year that the photosynthetic organisms of today capture. 80 to 90% of all of Earth's limestone and marble are made up of marine organism skeletal fragments, with limestone and marble making up 6% of the total volume of the Earth's sedimentary rock, marble being a sedimentary rock that went through metamorphosis. It is, quite frankly, not possible for this amount of biological material to have existed in a living state all at the same time, and keep in mind, this is just what survived to make it into the fossil record, rocks, and various other biologically based materials. So much more would have just been lost to decay, but yeah, it was all alive at the exact same time, just impossibly piled on top of each other somehow.
So then the big question remains, if they were on board Noah's Ark and reintroduced after, then can we point to evidence of people after the Flood that knew about these animals?
So from here on out, we all know that this guy is talking about non-avian dinosaurs, and I have pointed out that birds are dinosaurs, so no need for the pedants to comment that by dinosaur we actually mean non-avian dinosaur. But yeah, not only would we expect there to be evidence that people knew about the dinosaurs, we would expect there to be evidence of people having lived with them. And since dinosaurs and humans all met the same fate in the Flood, finding human remains with dinosaur remains would be the ideal bit of evidence for that, especially since just knowing about an animal from the fossil record is nothing special. I mean, that's exactly how we know about them. Why would we expect earlier cultures to have no knowledge of them whatsoever? Do we just assume that no culture before the 1800s ever found a fossil? So any description of something that we have fossil evidence for must be from them having seen the living creature in person?
Can we point to that? Now, there's a couple of things for consideration here. We really shouldn't expect to find the word dinosaur mentioned anywhere in ancient history books, because the word dinosaur was coined very recently.
Sure, but we don't need an old text to specifically say dinosaur. We would need to find some human bones with dinosaur bones in the same temporal layer, though.
The first dinosaur actually discovered was discovered in 1822.
Not really. The first dinosaur bone that we have accurate records of having been discovered was found in 1677 by Robert Plot, but was not known to be a dinosaur bone at the time. It was named Megalosaurus in 1824 by William Buckland, making it the first naming of a species of dinosaur. The 1822 discovery that you are referencing was the iguanodon bone found by Marianne Martell, which became the second dinosaur species to receive a name a few years later. But the argument that humans did not coexist with dinosaurs is not based on a lack of appearance of the word dinosaur in ancient texts. This is a straw man. I have never seen anyone argue that we should find the word dinosaur appearing in texts before the word dinosaur was invented. Now, certainly, if there were a Hebrew word for the animals that we today classify as dinosaurs, then we would expect that modern translations of the Bible would be able to use the word dinosaur. After all, the English word serpent did not exist when the Bible was written, but we have no trouble translating the Hebrew word nachesh as serpent today. But no, we would not expect to see dinosaur show up in the 1611 King James translation.
Before the word dinosaur was coined, however, animals of this type were spoken of throughout history, collectively referred to by the term dragon.
Oh, they were they? So when we look at ancient art depicting dragons, we should see recognizable dinosaur species? So this Celtic dragon looks like a dinosaur? How about this Chinese dragon? This Italian one? This Greek one? Call me crazy, but I can't figure out which species of dinosaur these dragons are supposed to be. They don't look like any that I've ever heard of.
dragons. This is just a common name for this general group of animals that has been known for centuries.
See, now that head I could see going on a modern depiction of a dragon, but when you look at the rest of that one's body, it just looks like another pachycephalosaur. We've never found one with wings or any other characteristics that would make it look like what we think of when you say dragon. In fact, it is named Dracorax because, unlike all the other dinosaurs, its head looks like what we would think of as a dragon head. In other words, all of the dinosaurs except for this one didn't really look like what anyone thought of as a dragon. And after our concept of a dragon evolved to include some dinosaur-like features, we found a dinosaur that had features that were, up to that point, just imagination. So we named a real creature after one that we had made up. So we found species that actually kind of resembles a dragon, named it Dracorax, therefore dragons were real, we just call them dinosaurs now, even though no dragon illustration before the discovery of dinosaurs actually looks anything like a dinosaur.
In May 2017, a new dinosaur species was discovered. The species name given to it was Bilbilong sinensis, which means the baby dragon of China.
Sure, but again, like, do you see the picture of it that you're showing? Does that look like anything you've ever seen called a dragon before? Seriously, I've seen fish that look more like a dragon than those guys. Though, to be fair, we do refer to it as a monster dinosaur puppy fish in my house, so I said it looks like a dragon and a dinosaur. Checkmate evolutionists!
Everyone recognizes that dinosaurs possess the characteristics ascribed to dragons of old.
Some of them, sometimes, yes. And clearly it's impossible for anyone before the 1800s to have ever seen a dinosaur fossil. Sure, we have records of fossil finds going back before the time of Herodotus in ancient Greece, but there's no way anyone could have found a dinosaur fossil before modern times.
Just for whatever reason, the obviousness of this interpretation that these were dinosaurs has been lost or avoided because paleontologists have asserted that dinosaurs went extinct 65 million years ago.
It is most definitely not an assertion. There is way too much evidence for it. For instance, the fact that no dinosaur fossil has ever been found in rocks younger than that. But how do we know the rocks are that old? Well, we have lots of ways of figuring that out, none of which are based on assertions.
But every place you look, every country in the world, we're talking from Scandinavia, throughout Europe, England, over here in Mesoamerica, every country that has records going back into antiquity invariably contains records of and stories, depictions of dragons, the people who had seen them or had killed them, revered as heroes.
Ha! Joke's on you. The word dragon wasn't invented in English until the 13th century, but the records you're talking about go back way before that. Checkmate creationist. Joking aside, let's just look at the etymology for a second. The English word dragon comes from the French word dragon, which in turn comes from the Latin draconum, which is a word in Latin that can just mean huge serpent. But the Latin came from the Greek drakon, which literally means serpent or giant sea fish. So if we look at the pictures of dragons that ancient cultures drew, they look very snake-like, and the word itself comes from a word that means serpent or giant sea fish. Not very dinosaurian. And yeah, I didn't show any Mesoamerican dinosaurs earlier, so let's see what they thought a dragon should look like, shall we? Here's Quetzalcoatl, the feathered serpent. Seems like dragons have more in common with snakes than they do with dinosaurs. It's almost like people, when creating mythological creatures, don't really make new creations. They make hybrids of creatures that they are more familiar with. Giant snake with wings like a bird and claws and face of an alligator? There you go, you get a pretty decent picture of most cultures' dragons. And now, today, when someone says dragon, you picture a big CG monster from Harry Potter or Game of Thrones, which have been given dinosaur-like features because we now know a lot more about dinosaurs than we did when the dragon myths were originally created, and some dinosaur features look really cool.
The Chinese zodiac, for example, contains multiple different animals, all of them everyday animals. The only animal on there that's not an everyday animal we can all recognize is a dragon.
Yes, the Chinese zodiac has dragons as their only mythological inclusion, which, of course, you are arguing is somehow evidence that dragons are not mythological. Except even in your own presentation, you have a picture of a Chinese zodiac with a dragon that doesn't look anything like a dinosaur. So if you want me to accept that dinosaurs lived with people because of dragon legends, could you not at least find a picture that has a dragon that at least somewhat resembles some species of dinosaur?
Several countries have dragons on their national flags, such as the UK country of Wales and the Kingdom of Bhutan in Southeast Asia.
Yep. Now tell me, what dinosaur species are those? Which dinosaur species had wings? This is such a weak argument. Next, you'll be pulling out the dragons breathing fire because of air friction as they tried to breathe through small nostrils argument.
This city seal in the Netherlands from 1925 has a dragon on its city seal.
You finally get something that looks a bit like a bird, and so consequently also a bit like a dinosaur, and you miss the mark. That's a basilisk, not a dragon. Now certainly the two are related, but the one depicted there seems to be an amalgam of a rooster and a snake, rather than just a snake that kills you when it looks at you type of basilisk.
The scene there is inspired by Revelations, where Michael kills the dragon. That was Satan.
Yes, that scene in Revelation, where Michael casts down the dragon that is Satan. Except that's the Greek word drakon, the one that means serpent or giant sea fish, and didn't come to mean what we think of as a dragon until the 13th century. It even uses a synonym for snake, Ophis, in the same story with reference to the same character. So clearly whoever wrote Revelation pictured a dragon as being snake-like, even if it was a monstrous snake.
It is also important to note that the word serpent has changed through time. In Old English diction, a serpent referred to a reptile with a long neck and long tail.
I would really like to know where you got that information. Because according to the Old English dictionary that I found online, serpent meant snake. So I looked up snake, maybe you got the words mixed up. It means legless reptile or wiggling animal without legs. Certainly not as specific as today's definition, but it is very specific about the lack of legs. So either show me your source for your Old English definition of serpent, or show me a dinosaur with no legs.
Here's a reference from the Bible for a dragon. This is again from Isaiah. In that day, the Lord with his sore and great sword shall punish Leviathan, the piercing serpent, even Leviathan, the crooked serpent, and he shall slay the dragon that is in the sea.
Yep, Leviathan, the sea monster that God fought. The sea monster who represents Tiamat, the Mesopotamian serpent goddess of the salt sea and primordial chaos that Yahweh defeats in Genesis 1. You sure that's something you want to bring up when arguing for young earth creationist talking points? Because the fact that the Hebrew religion did the same thing to the Babylonian religion that the Babylonians had done to the religions that came before them doesn't really do much to convince me that it's an accurate, perfect story that is meant to be interpreted literally.
Bible commentaries often, especially like the NIV and some of these later translations, have suggested that that was probably just an alligator or a crocodile. Since it was definitely an animal known to Job and his friends, God was describing this animal.
Well, I don't think it actually was just a crocodile, especially given the interpretation that Leviathan represented Tiamat, which fits with common Mesopotamian motifs of the time. But let's just play along. We have a crocodile, which can get quite large, and Job says it breathes fire. Okay, crocodiles don't breathe fire, but the rest of the description fits. Are you saying that dinosaurs do breathe fire? Is that what you're saying? Please be saying that. Please.
There's another animal described in the book of Job that is also probably a dinosaur. It's called a behemoth.
Yep, behemoth. In previous videos, I have stated my opinion that behemoth was a hippo. Some prefer elephant. But it is also possible that behemoth is a stand-in for Apsu, Tiamat's mate. Given their proximity and the possible etymological connection between behemoth, the Hebrew word translated as behemoth, and bohu, the Hebrew word in Genesis 1 for the void, and given the similarities of this whole motif of the story of Marduk conquering Tiamat and Apsu with Yahweh standing in for the storm god Marduk, I find this rather convincing. But as with most things, I imagine these mythical creatures had their basis in real animals. So behemoth might be a giant monster hippo, and Leviathan a giant snaky crocodile. But either way, they don't have to be dinosaurs to make the passage make sense.
Behold now, behemoth, which I made as well as you. He eats grass like an ox. Behold now, his strength is his loins, and his power is in the muscles of his belly. He bends his tail like a cedar. The sinews of his thighs are knit together. His bones are tubes of bronze. His limbs are like bars of iron. The NASB describes the tail as it bends like a cedar. The NIV says it sways like a cedar, but...
Yes, and given the context of the first part of that verse being about the strength in his loins, it is entirely possible, likely even, that tail here is a euphemism for penis. It's a biblical dick joke. Look at Behemoth. He eats grass but has sturdy balls and likes to wave his dick around. That's the official Rhino translation.
So some of the Bible commentaries will argue that this was either an elephant or hippopotamus. Because again, it had to be a modern animal, something known to Job and his friends. But the description of its tail doesn't fit either of those animals.
Well, the word used for moves in moves his tail like a cedar could also be translated as make stiff or extends, which makes a lot of sense when talking about elephant or hippo penises. It could also be translated as takes pleasure in. So, yeah, it's a penis.
Because neither of them have a tail that bends like a cedar or sways like a cedar. Both of them have a little spindly tail.
Have you ever seen a cedar tree? They grow really, really slowly. I have cedar trees in my front yard that have been there since I moved into this house some 10 years ago, and they are still less than a meter tall, and they are quite flexible. You might even call them small and spindly. They sway and move in the breeze quite easily. So even if it weren't a penis, which it totally is, it still doesn't exclude elephants or hippos because their tails do sway around and move around, especially hippos. They could do their helicopter poop thing with their tails. That moves pretty good. So yeah, could still be an elephant or a hippo.
But there's also certain chapters, like this one chapter, part of chapter 14 in Daniel has been removed from the canon because it describes Daniel killing a dragon. And, of course, dragons didn't exist at that time.
And here I was starting to think that we were going to get through this one without you providing your own rebuttal. Of course, dragons didn't exist at that time, so this chapter that mentions dragons is apocryphal. But hey, this chapter mentions dragons, so there must have been real dragons. Now, I'm skipping about 13 minutes of him just listing various dragon legends from around the world. You can give it a watch if you want. It's rather dull, and every single one of the dragons that he shows look nothing like any dinosaurs that we know of, with most of them being variations on serpents, sometimes with wings and or feathers. The closest he gets to something that actually looks like a dinosaur is the Cambodian temple ruin with what looks like a stegosaurus on it. And yeah, I'll admit that of all the dinosaur depictions that creationists love to bring up, this one is certainly the most convincing, which kind of shows how weak the argument is. The best depiction of a dinosaur from antiquity is something that looks like a clay sculpture put together by a child. But anyway, if you zoom out from the picture a bit, you'll see that not only are the stegosaur's back plates continued on the outside of the circle as if they are more part of the background than part of the animal, but you'll also see that the carvings above and below it have similar characteristics. Their shapes are slightly different, but the same shapes are on the inside surrounding their subject in the same way that the stegosaurus ones are.
Now, one of the claims that's often made about these ancient depictions of dinosaurs is that these ancient peoples just figured out what they look like the way we have.
Yeah, that certainly is one potential explanation. In fact, it's one of the better ones. Since they didn't have the technology available to them that we have today, they wouldn't have been able to put the bones together quite as easily as we do today. So you might end up with a Tyrannosaurus head on a serpent body instead of on a theropod body. So that would not only explain the legend, but it would explain why there are zero accurate depictions of dinosaurs from antiquity. But that's not a required explanation. As I pointed out, and as you managed to point out yourself over the last 13 minutes, none of the dragon myths look anything like dinosaurs. The most likely explanation is just that humans have a thing against snakes, and some snakes get really big, so the human imagination exaggerated that and made monsters out of them.
They had found fossils. They were able to figure out what those fossils look like and created reconstructions of them. The problem with that is, in particular for the stegosaur here, is that the stegosaur plates, much like the osteoderms possessed by the ankylosaur, were not attached to its skeleton.
Okay, how is that a problem? As I pointed out, given the overall motif of the artwork in the area of that temple, it is entirely likely that what we are seeing as Stegosaurus plates were just meant to be part of the background. Our brains like to see familiar things even when there's nothing there. Go look at the clouds sometime and tell me you don't find shapes and patterns in them. So what the original artist of this animal thought of as obviously background because they just weren't familiar with the Stegosaurus, we see as part of the animal because our brains actively work to make something look more like what we've decided it should be. Even if I grant everything that you're saying, if it actually is a Stegosaurus, how do you know they didn't find a remarkably intact fossil where the plates were obviously lined up where they were supposed to be on the animal? We know this type of fossil exists. We've seen them. So there are a few choices here. A. The plates were not meant to appear connected to the animal, but because we are familiar with an animal that looked kinda like that with plates, it looks that way to us. B. They found a very well-preserved fossil and dedicated some art to it. C. All of geology, biology, paleontology, anthropology, and archaeology are wrong, and we really did live with the dinosaurs. Oh, and also D, it's not a very well-protected temple, and movie crews have been filming there for decades, so one of the crews might have carved it as a joke or as a background prop for a movie or something. That one seems like a stretch to me, though. Not as much of a stretch as C, but still a bit of a stretch.
Now, regarding these illustrations, it's important to note that that these were often made much later than the original sightings. The original descriptions were made, and so the engraver of these illustrations had no way of verifying the accuracy of some of these depictions. And often some of them seem to be composites of multiple dinosaurs by peoples of ancient times who had heard of different accounts of different dinosaurs, but assumed there was only really one type. So a lot of them seem to be composites.
There you go, debunking yourself again. They are composites not of dinosaurs, but of common animals that we know today. Birds, snakes, crocodiles, bats, and whatnot. You bring these dragon legends up as supposed evidence that dinosaurs coexisted with humans, and then you point out that the drawings of these dragons are all composite creatures, and you're claiming that they are composites of different dinosaurs, but that's just not the case.
Interestingly, I looked it up, and there were actually a bunch of people sainted for killing dragons. This is a list of people sainted for killing dragons. People didn't get sainted willy-nilly by the Catholic Church.
No, you're right. Everything had to be verified as being accurate and truly miraculous. That's why when sainting Thomas Aquinas, they went with the miracle of him wanting fish while sick, and then miraculously a fishmonger showed up to sell fish, and then Thomas changed his mind and didn't want fish anymore. Seriously, that was one of Thomas Aquinas' miracles. They have a pretty low bar. That's it for today. I skipped a lot of his video, but most of it was just him listing dragon legends, and amusingly, he often did bring up the fact that the legendary dragons breathed fire, as if that lent his point credibility somehow, but he never actually went the way of trying to explain that dinosaurs breathed fire, so it wasn't as fun as it could have been. Today's comment of the day comes to us from Kurt N., who says, I was interrupted by 2 6-minute soap ads while listening to you on a wireless set. Yes, I am whining and will continue to do so until I stop subscribing to your channel. Too bad or good riddance? Basically, I'm just using this comment as a springboard to talk behind-the-scenes stuff about ads for a bit. YouTube has recently changed something about their ad system. I mean, in addition to adding mid-roll ads to shorter videos now, it seems that they have put more ads in, regardless of how many or how few ad breaks I manually place. I usually stick to just like one ad placed every 8 minutes, but people tell me they sometimes get 6 or 7 ads in one video, so obviously YouTube is stuffing extra ads in there somewhere. To try and mitigate this, what I will be doing for my next few videos at least is splitting them into parts. Instead of one half-hour-ish video, it will be 2 15-minute-ish videos. Hopefully with a shorter video, YouTube feels the need to stuff fewer ads in where I haven't manually placed them, and then my 2 videos a week become 4 videos a week for you guys, so I'm hoping this will be a win-win scenario that makes everyone happy. But this is the internet, so I know there's probably already somebody angrily typing away that they don't want any split videos, you should do all the same way you do it now, change is bad. It's an experiment, bear with me. If it works, I'll keep it up. If it doesn't, I'll go back to normal. Thanks for watching. Special thanks as always to my patrons, especially David Schinkel, Lynn Dobbs, Mark McManus, and What Jesus, who are the fire-breathing dragons that prove the existence of the dinosaur that is my channel. If you'd like me to be more mythical, you can support the channel for as little as $1 per week over at patreon.com/vicerhino. Other ways to support the channel, such as direct donation or my Amazon wishlist, are linked in the description, as well as my social media accounts and my P.O. Box address. See you next time!